Hello, hockey fans. You know, during the past 11 years, it's been my privilege from this perch to share with you some of the great moments of Flames hockey. Now we want to do something different. We want you to join us on a journey that will take you from the beginnings of the franchise in Atlanta, Georgia, all the way to the quest for a second Stanley Cup. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the Flames into the 90s. Road trip, a fact of life in the NHL. Time to haul out the bags. Kiss the family goodbye and go to work. They look like young executives, but more often than not, their office is an airport. Veteran Tim Hunter is one of the Flames' captains, and he's the captain of the boarding passes, too.
Good one, Danny.
Time to kill before the plane leaves on a 5-day trip to Vancouver and Los Angeles. So time for some ice cream. And time to sign the first autographs of the trip.
Oh, write your check. This one will probably bounce, so.
I think he's got
a
thing.
Hey?
It's too bad you lost
really?
This.
Really? Yeah, it is too bad we lost. Thank you.
Coach Doug Risebrow boards the plane last. But he's the victim of the first practical joke. Somehow, Archie Comics just don't fit Riser's image. Risebrow is in his first year as head coach, and the Flames have introduced a lot of new faces this year. There's Kari Wilson, Robert Reichel, and Ronnie Stern. Paul Fenton, Kevin Guy, the bashful Frank Musil, Sleepy Stefan Matteau, Jim Kite, and new assistant coach Guy Charron. They're joining a confident organization, a team that has a history of having fun. And that's because they have a history of winning. The Flames' history began in 1972 when they were the Atlanta Flames. The team was stationed in the Deep South for 8 years before moving to Calgary in 1980. This is Atlanta today, a city where old meets new. Host city for the 1996 Summer Olympics, Atlanta is constantly moving forward while still retaining a proud sense of its past. This fall, the Flames did some time traveling, visiting the city of their birth for 2 exhibition games.
Now, when you see the Flames play out there tonight,
You kind of just wish that Flaming C was a Flaming A now.
Yeah. Hey, Dad, I wish all the old guys were back. They were great, but I'm glad to see the team do as it is. I wish them a lot of success. I understand they're a fantastic team, and I'm glad to have them back in Atlanta.
See, I still got my Atlanta Flames t-shirt. It's 10 years old, bought in 1980.
Looks as good as new.
Sure is. Same as the Flames.
The fans haven't forgotten about the Flames, and the Flames haven't forgotten Atlanta. A number of former players now live in the city.
My fondest memory was, I guess, when I won Rookie of the Year here, my first year in the league. I wasn't even expected to make the team, and then I ended up making the team and, you know, missed the first 16 games. I spent the 16 games in the minors, and then to come back and they put me with the two best players on the team, with Lysiak and Eric Vail.
You know, we had the town excited, we had the city excited, and then, we didn't finish it off. We never finished it off with any playoff appearances or... You know, we're always in the playoffs, but we just never got past that first round. And, when we got to Calgary, that first year we were up there, we got to the semifinals.
Cliff Fletcher has been with the Flames since the beginning. He and his right-hand man, Al McNeil, have seen the Flames go from an expansion team to an NHL powerhouse.
The atmosphere in Calgary is such, it's far more conducive to winning in that there's pressure on the players to perform. Whereas here down south, when a player leaves the rink after practice or a game, he may not hear the word hockey until he comes back the next day or a couple days later.
Today, the Flames are flying high. In 1991, they recorded their third 100-point season, and a big part of it, a pair of 100-point scorers, Al MacInnis and Theron Fleury.
Comes back to MacInnis, the drive scores!
MacInnis had his best season ever, 103 points. Only the fourth defenseman in NHL history to hit the century mark. Still, it was another set of numbers people were interested in, as Chopper signed a contract making him the Flames' first million-dollar man. But he did a great job keeping it in perspective.
I realize how very fortunate I am to be where I'm at and to go to a job every day where I played it since I was about 5 years old and how much I love the game. The most important thing is, I grew up in Cape Breton in a large family where we didn't have a lot of extra stuff, and the hockey equipment we had was always the hand-me-downs and the skates and gloves and what have you. And I have brothers and sisters back in Port Hood that... work very hard for an average income, and when I go down there in the summer or talk to them on the phone, it really brings everything back.
McClellan up into center for Fleury. He's working with Reichel. Fleury on it, front, shoots, I scores! What a goal! Theron Fleury knows all about overcoming obstacles. No one thought the 5'6" dynamite was big enough to play big league hockey. No one, that is, except Theo himself. And now that he's here, he's having the time of his life.
And I remember we were in Toronto, staying at one of the hotels, and kid came up to me with the hockey card, and I asked him, where'd you get this? And he goes, well, this is your, this is your rookie card. And I was, like, pretty excited, and I asked him for it, and he gave it to me. So those type of things are great, I think.
Theo, it's been great watching you play. My personal Theron Fleury memory, is there any doubt? 2 minutes, 10 seconds remaining, third period of play. As we mentioned earlier, both Fleury, well, here's Gilmore coming over the line, gets it over to Fleury, trapped it up and scores! There it is! 100 points, 50 goals!
That's the last time that puck will touch the ice. Theron Fleury will have that, and quite a treasure it will be. The interesting thing on this, Gilmore knows Fleury's with him all the way, and Fleury tries to pass it across to Ranheim. In the unselfish way that this goal develops, it's kind of neat that Fleury ends up scoring it. He goes across to his line mate. The puck gets knocked back, and 20,132 are still on their feet.
They're still giving an overwhelming ovation to number 14, Theron Fleury.
Life on the road isn't as glamorous as you might believe. When the Flames hit Vancouver, it's straight to their hotel rooms, a quick phone call home, some television, and then time to hit the hay to get ready for the game the next night. Rick Walmsley and Gary Roberts have roomed together for three seasons, and for the most part, it's a good arrangement.
Well,
but
Gary, as being a representative for the Alberta Lung Association, has a asthmatic condition, and his wife will attest to, if Gary sleeps on his back, he snores rather loudly. And kind of get that Fred Flintstone effect, you know, where he breathes in, the curtains go this way, and he breathes out, they go out the windows. So every once in a while during the night, I got to tell Gary to roll over, in which he is happy to wake up and roll over for me.
I still can't understand why he wakes me up when he has to, you know, why can't he just come over and kind of roll me over instead of yelling at me or throwing the telephone at me? I still haven't figured that one out.
Gary also has a quick trigger finger. Just watch him work that remote control.
Well, I think Richard has most of the seniority, so I let him take care of most of the things, but I have to put my foot down once in a while when it comes to the TV shows.
There's a couple times I have to throw my weight around a bit, and, you know.
We've been known to have a few fights over the converter once in a while.
Yeah. Rip a t-shirt here and there.
We leave. Usually bring an extra t-shirt on the road because one usually gets ripped before the trip's over. But all in all, we get along pretty well, and we have a lot of fun together.
Mm-hmm.
There's a brain surgeon right there.
The next morning, time to get out of bed and go to work. The day of game skate at the Pacific Coliseum. Theron Fleury brings along the music.
Just tied a worm wore. I just got here. I wore three pairs of socks. I wouldn't do them up early at all.
There he is, Scuba Makarov. Taping up a stick. That's how they do it, the stick handlers.
This is our last paycheck, last road trip. Very depressing.
Rick Walmsley, 20-minute workout. First, we do an overall stretch.
Kids, you want to make the NHL? Not the floor.
They're actually sharks jaws. Put them up on the wall. Sharks jaws. All right, get out of here.
Bobby Stewart story?
Bobby, you watch your hands.
Joe Neuendijk must wrap his knee before every practice and every game.
To the back of your socks, eh?
Hey, what's you?
Frankie, you're on TV.
I'm.
Say hi to Andrew. Andrew!
Hello, Andy. Hi, Andy. How are you?
Oh, you!
Hello, Andrew. It's the boys. Can Frankie come out and play?
Wherever you're ready, Frankie.
It's exciting, isn't it?
The Flames don't work too hard the day of a game. Just break a sweat and make sure the goalies get the feel of the puck.
So I'm going to take the D with Bernie. Okay.
One on one.
He's injured.
No, he's gonna play. Yeah, yes. It's Gabe Plazek and Nordmark after, so I guess he was out here today. He got a bruised knee.
The Flames have their work to do, and so does the 2-7 telecast team. My partner, Grant Pollock, researches an upcoming interview with Gary Roberts.
As much as I haven't scored as much this year, I still feel like things have gone fairly well. I mean, obviously I didn't get off
a great start.
It was a
rough beginning, the whole
beginning and the whole line, but now things have kind of come together. And, trying to, I think, keep things simpler instead of worrying so much about scoring, just doing the things.
Maybe you're not worrying about fighting, like you don't have to fight so much.
I don't think I'm worried about it. I think when the opportunity's there, I mean, I don't think there's a doubt that if something happens out there, I'll try and do it. I'll be there.
And later, I chat with Sergei Makarov to tell him he did a great job the week before in his first uninterpreted television interview.
I hear a lot of people saying you just did a good job. No, they're very pleased. I was pleased you tried it. I know it's tough, you know, but you know, you did a good job. I think he was better than Brian.
Oh, come on. Right.
Sergei Makarov is in his second year with the Flames. On the ice, he's created some of the NHL's prettiest goals.
A brilliant individual effort. He digs Stevens right out of his wallet, and that's tough to do these days, and then puts it up over Randall.
Off the ice, the adjustment hasn't been easy, but Sergei has worked hard to adapt to a different culture.
Very good people living here. It's like it hockey. People like it hockey. Like it hockey players. It's very good. And it's good relation. I have good relation with my neighbors and my kids. It's maybe first thing because I like it living in Calgary. It's small town. It's good for family.
Ну что, идем вместе все. Пошли, в машину. Тихонько, не спеши. Все нормально?
Today he picks up son Tom at school, and his arrival is big news.
My mom won't let me. I gotta.
Oh, there's my Sergei.
Or this.
Tom, Sergei, and his wife Vera are enjoying North American living, and Tom's eyes light up when he talks about one of our customs.
During Christmas time, that was the most exciting thing for our whole year because we never had Christmas in Russia. We only celebrate New Year. So this is where it's like, can't find a word, like a flip. I opened my present, was the all I wanted.
One of the best things about life in North America, the food. And hours before their game that night, the Flames chow down at a team meal.
I like the food.
Incoming.
Whoops. Uh-oh.
It's the best stuff you can have for cleaning.
Checking out my little dinner.
Bad for you. Very bad.
Think the people are going to like this?
I don't think so.
Following an afternoon nap, it's on the bus and time to put the game faces on. With the hockey card craze, the Flames practice their signature now more than ever.
Come on, Heimer.
Same way.
Four-pointer, boys. Come on, another one.
10 minutes before game time. The Flames are in their world now.
Here we go now.
Come on, boys.
Sure, shoot the puck, kid.
Open the receipt, boys.
The Flames are driving for first in the Smythe, and they know it's late in the season, and every point counts.
This is an exciting time right now. An exciting time, and it's also a very tense time. Can't get around that. An exciting time because of the position we're in, the opportunity that we have, and individually, you're getting tested. And when you succeed, the fruits of that success, you feel a lot more. Maybe because of the tension, maybe because of the trauma, maybe because of the competition. But there is that element of fun. And you gotta enjoy the battle. And we need that. We need, the last thing we need is to put all the worries and the pressure on. We just need to go out there and perform and worry about ourselves. That's all we've done. When we work hard, when we're prepared, then everything else becomes fun. Don't shortchange yourself out there. Have a good game.
Come on, Red. Come on, Theo. Come on, Cater.
The Flames have a set pattern when they hit the ice. Vernon, followed by Fleury. The rest fall in, and James McCown is always the last man.
Come on, Dewey. Come on, Jimmy boy. Come on, Ronnie. Come on, boys. Come on, boys.
The game gets underway, and so does the instruction from the coach.
Keep skating, kid. Especially at that blue line, because everybody's timing. Keep skating. I didn't think it was either, but they're not gonna call it close. They're gonna, anytime it's close, they're gonna give you.
Taking three. That a boy, Frankie.
Don't make it close. Don't make it close. Puck carrier skates, the other guys wait. Don't make it close.
Doug Risebrough was intense as a player, and the fire still burns now that he's the Flames' bench boss.
Jump, jump! Go to the net! Stay on the net! That's it, that's it, that's it! Head coaching is the closest thing to playing. And for me, I think I understood that coaching was very close to playing. Being head coach and having that input of making decisions that are going to affect the outcome of a game, not only in planning a game attack, but certainly as the game goes on, is a fun part of it, and you don't have to deal with the bruises. But it's been perfect timing for me. I don't know if I'd enjoy it as much had I not played. For me, I really don't know any other business. I enjoy this business because I think you see people in their raw emotion. You see them on the edge all the time, and I think you learn more about them quicker, and I think you learn more about yourself that way. Well, I think the biggest thing is personally is just to trust your own instincts. That in our time frame, not always do you have the luxury of a lot of time to make decisions, and that whatever background information you have, whatever however little it is, that you have to make a decision, and that the worst thing is not making a decision. And I've realized that I don't have as the luxury of always analyzing problems. I have to solve them as they come.
The Flames get off to a slow start, trailing 1-0 in the first. But in the second, they start to get their chances. And it eventually pays off.
Breaking in, Gilmore scores! Beautiful goal!
The game is tied at 2-2.
That's it, Red. That's it, Red.
Come on, boys. Come on, boys.
Now we go. Now we go.
Bernie. I didn't want to block that one with curvers.
Please, Gilmore.
On edge like that. I didn't want to come across. I thought it would come across the middle if I started to come down.
No, I wanted to get it down.
I'm going to try it.
I threw it on the boards and it came back to the middle.
I threw it up on the glass and then it kicked out. Will you kind of jump over your stick? I thought your guy was coming over there. So I just want to put it on the boards or the ice for him to get it.
Defensive zone coverage, we've got to simplify it. If you're the contact man, that's what we're looking for. You can't take the man out, find the puck, and move the puck. It can't happen. So what we need is we need contact and elimination. Put it at the goalie, he does not handle the puck well, and we've got to have penetration through. Simple game. We haven't played our best. Our best is yet to come. Our best is yet to come. We've got to present our best in this period. Come on, boys. It's up for grabs. It's up for grabs. It's ours.
Come on, Theo. Watts.
Yep.
Come on, scoop up. Come on.
Pressure on.
Come on. Skate. Same way, Jimmy boy. Come on.
We're going.
Johnny, ready.
Not very good.
Take it to him.
Same thing. If it's shallow there, don't yell for the puck, okay? We're trying to get our forwards to give the puck deep. Yeah, unless you're wide open, but it's crowded. He came out of the spin. He gave it to you. You're caught. You know, if he's down at the hash marks, it's a different story. Then you got more room.
That would give the club a lot of lift. Finally, Paul Ranheim scores in the third to win it. 3-2.
Deflection in front. They score! Ranheim parked in front.
How'd it be, Red?
Great job.
Yeah. Way to work, Brett.
The win is especially sweet for ex-Canuck Ronnie Sterling.
Oh, what a feeling.
That's a character win, boys. Way to work. Way to come back.
Extremely large win, boys.
All right, boys.
Yeah.
Another 2 points. What's the score in LA?
4-2.
4-2 in the third?
4-4.
4-4.
That's all right. We thought we were going to have to beat them ourselves anyway, so.
We better back, boys. That's the way.
So, it's on to sunny California for a first-place showdown with the Kings. But first, a rare day off. This late in the season, however, there's no time for sightseeing. The Flames Lounge.
Steph is a good guy. He shares everything.
Eat. And sleep around the pool at their LA hotel.
Well, you come here different times of the year, maybe different holidays where there's just before Christmas, we'd go out, we'd do some shopping, and it's a thing, I think, sightseeing at times, but this is an important time for us, as everybody knows back in Calgary, as well as our team knows, and we were in here last year, not long down the road, and we got beat out, and we do not want that to happen, and right now we have a goal in mind, and that's to take first in our division, and then after that, we're going to prepare ourselves for the playoffs.
A road trip is also a great opportunity to get to know new teammates.
I think it's very important to be able to come on the road and get to know your new teammates and things, but the good part about this team is everybody accepts you. It's very easy. There's been about six of us that have come in this year that are new, and it's nice to be accepted the way that we have. I think a lot of it has to do with the organization, the way people accept you, the way that they treat you. It's nothing but a class organization here.
At practice the next day, an example of that class, the Flames welcome 11-year-old Rod Yollop, a young man from Ontario battling cancer. He's in L.A. to visit the Flames as part of the Children's Wish program.
Phil, I'll hold you. Phil, down in front.
Phil, down in front.
Dax!
You watch the picture.
You got a white room?
Get back to you there.
Cheese!
Come on in here, Rodney. You know who that guy is?
Hey, Rodney.
You know Doug Gilmer? He's a little upset with you because you got a Doug Gilmer or a... You and that jersey.
No, that's
not a
okay.
Doug Gilmer.
Joe makes more money than all of us, so that's okay.
That's right. So what do you think? Think we can beat these LA Kings tomorrow?
Probably. You know it, buddy.
You gonna cheer us on? Or are you a Wayne Gretzky fan?
No, I'll cheer you.
Alright, good. We need your support.
Back home in Calgary, the Flames are involved in countless charitable endeavors, many of them in support of the Alberta Children's Hospital. They play an annual wheelchair hockey game against kids from hospitals, Gordon Townsend School. They visit the hospital every year around the Christmas holidays.
Merry Christmas to you. Hey, it looks like these days you've already been here, eh?
Yeah, looks like you've already been
here. All right. Merry Christmas to you, man.
We got the name.
How are you?
All set?
Merry Christmas.
Thank you. You get out
Merry
for Christmas,
Alonzo?
Yes.
All right,
so are you going home
Lewis,
today?
Right?
All right.
What a
great up.
What's his name? Who is that?
Oh,
what guy is
What's
that?
What's the guy's name, Jeff?
The bad guys were like, you know what Michelangelo looks like this?
Is that the guy that says Calabunga dude?
Yeah, I think
And they even donate their time waiting tables at a fundraising event for the hospital. They say charity begins at home. And Calgary has been home for Tim Hunter his entire life. He's been a Flame for 10 years and long ago played his minor hockey here.
So we'll take you out here to where the two sets of permanent boards were.
This is where it all began, in the Acadia community. This is where Tim first laced on the skates and dreamed of the NHL.
The kiddie rink, what have you, was located in this area here. Everyone used to skate across the kids' rink to get to the big rinks, and I think that intimidated a lot of the youngsters. I remember, you know, being 3 and 4 years old, and all the big kids skating across the kiddie rink to go to play their games and being intimidating, yet excited at the same time to see the real hockey players going out to play, and it was fun to try to be one of them or imitate them as they went out in the ice onto the game. I never thought I had the talent. I knew I had the work ethic and the desire, but I didn't think I had the talent. But maybe all the nights till 10 or 11 o'clock over here at the rink by myself or with my brothers paid off. You know, the hockey games would be over and we'd come over and turn the lights on and play by ourselves and just have fun shooting the puck, even if we weren't skating, just on our boots. And I think the chance that my parents gave me, you know, being so supportive is what really helped.
Tim's dad still lives in the house Tim grew up in. He shares Tim's many memories. including the day that Tim decided to retire prematurely.
So then he said, later on he said, I quit hockey. So later on that night, the coach phoned me and he said, how's Timmy? And I said, oh, he's fine. I said, what happened to him in skating today? He says, well, he says he told me to shove the hockey team up his, you know what. So after about 2 or 3 weeks, he went back.
I think it was that long.
It was
2 or 3 weeks.
No, it was quite a while.
No.
Yes, it was. It was only three or four days. No way. I was explaining. I said, you have to stand on the snowbank with me all winter long. I don't care, you said.
There's, where is he? He should be in the picture. I think he played that team.
There's Dad.
There's you, Daddy.
Today, Tim's family includes wife Kim and his two daughters, Kelsey and Taryn.
See? That's the cup. We're gonna win another one, aren't we, Kels?
Yeah.
On this day, Hunter's family is a long way away. It's game day, a first place showdown with the LA Kings.
Come on,
they're winning 3-1.
They're gonna be watching this in Russell, Manitoba.
The game plan is on the board.
You learn something about yourself in this business all the time. We learned something positive the other day. That although the game wasn't great against these guys last time, we knew we could play better. We also knew that we had to get on and not worry about it. And we found ways of winning the next two games. Something that they failed to do. We talked about our plan going back 7 weeks ago. The idea was just to get playing the best we could play and not worry about anything. And put the pressure right on them. Put the pressure right on them. They're talking about it. The plan's working. In the papers, they're saying the last 7 weeks has been like playoffs for us. Every day we wake up and they know they're right there. Every day. The plan is working.
But sometimes, no matter how much you plan, it just doesn't work. The Kings run up an 8-0 lead.
Weber, Weber, let's go! Weber, let's go! Hey!
The Flames show some character, scoring 4 straight goals, but it ends 8-4. So, the road trip comes to an end. And a few weeks later, the regular schedule ends, the Kings edging the Flames out for first place in the Smythe Division. So the door closes on the regular season, and the playoffs begin. And what a playoff it is. Another edition of the Battle of Alberta against the Edmonton Oilers. And it had everything. Big hits.
Simpson belted by Natras, and Natras is down. Knocked down by Graves. And Graves continues after Roberts. And finally, the Oilers get possession.
Great goals.
Fleury shoots. Fury the stop. Rebound. They score. Now Wilson takes the pass from Stern. In it goes to Ranheim. Stern driving. Ranheim scores. Here comes Nieuwendyk inside the line. Roberts scores.
Goals that didn't count, that should have. Like this one by Joe Nieuwendyk in game one. Great saves.
Joe Murphy stops and hesitates, and Natras goes past him a little bit, but look at the position on Vernon.
Hakkinen on the near side. The shot in front, Anderson, and a big glove stop by Vernon. And Anderson showed his frustration at being robbed.
We'll start to open things up.
Messier to Anderson in alone. And Vernon, there's Messier onside. Mark Messier has a break in, and Vernon again. With some speed, moves in, shoots, and a big stop by Vernon with the glove hand. And that's as hard as we've seen Messier shoot the puck in this series.
Close calls.
Behind the net, Wilson tied up. Centering pass, right goal, and he backhanded wide.
In a series that could have gone either way, the Flames find themselves down 3-1. But the Sea of Red are still believers, and soon, seeing is believing. Game 5, the Flames crowd the net, and Cary Wilson scores on the deflection. Then Wilson scores again, and the Flames win the game 5-3. It's back to Edmonton. Game 6. Again, the Flames have their chances.
A break from center. Ranheim against Fuhr, and what a stop!
And eventually it pays off. Paul Ranheim scores to tie the game at 1, forcing overtime. And facing elimination, the Flames' little big man comes up with the goal of his life.
Messier gives it away. Here's Fleury, looking for his first goal of the series. Scores! And Theron Fleury and the Flames are in seventh heaven.
He gave me the glove right from the time I got the puck. I noticed that he was way over in the net, and I was actually a little bit surprised too that I was able to go 5-hole on him. He goes down quick, and he's played such a great series that it seems the breaks have been going his way, and he's just played well. I think every kid growing up dreams of playing in a game 7, and. Especially against the Edmonton Oilers, because they're the defending Stanley Cup champions, and now we have an opportunity to do it, and we just gotta continue to play the way we have and go from there.
Game 7. The Flames are on fire early, scoring 3 straight first period goals.
Here's Reichel, that shot block. Rebound scores! Here's Suter, to do it right, scores! Fleury with 2 assists already. Ranheim shoots, and a nice kick save by Fuhr. Ranheim in front again. Fleury scores!
However, the Oilers recover. They lead 4-3 late in the third. But the Flames go for the equalizer on this play. Ronnie Stern scores to force the second overtime game in a row. In the extra session, the Flames get some great chances.
Here's Cary Wilson moving. Looking to center, Graves crawls. Benton's in front. Wilson jams. Fuhr is down. Puck still loose. Otto tapped on it. And Grant Fuhr keeps it out. Gilmore centers it. Here's a chance for Ranheim. It's blocked. Ranheim again. Can't get the shot away. Puck cleared to the corner. Anderson takes over. Flames have had the best chances so far.
But then, the dream dies.
And now Tinkerman circles at center. 3 points in the game. Four goals for SC Tinkerman. Six in the series. Shoot scores! SC Tinkerman has won it for the Oilers.
The Oilers win the series 4-3. A series that will go into the books as one of the finest in NHL history. And the Flames' history has shown this is a team that can bounce back. The future looks bright, and the Flames will be back next season as their quest for a second Stanley Cup continues.